Just a few announcements to bring to your attention. Cheryl and I will be away for the few days this week. We're leaving Monday and we're coming back Thursday. We are going to our denomination retreat for pastors in the coming days, making it sound very, you know, like meetings. But we are meeting in Banff, and so it's not hardship. The board, you can contact the board if there's anything that you need to speak to them about. And there is also Ron and John have kindly said they would be available if there's any sort of crisis. I know there's others here as well that you can call on. As well, on November 24th, in 2 weeks, we have our fall business meeting. The budget is available in the foyers. The agenda is available back there. I encourage you to take a look through it, read through it, and then if you have any questions or concerns about what you're seeing, to contact Derek or Kevin or anyone from the board now. If you have minor edits, Hillary, if you see things now's the time to note them. Then we can do that instead of during the meeting. And then today, we are going to begin with a moment of remembrance. Many of you will know that at the back, we have a list of over 100 young men and boys who at the time were farmers, these students in their first jobs, who all signed up and were sent to Europe in the first war. 11 were killed. This is just one of many churches in Canada. In 1918, when the war was over, 66,000 Canadians had been killed in Europe. Just under 200,000 had been injured. And it was decided that on the 11th month, the 11th day, the 11th hour, that Canadians would stop what they were doing, they would have a moment of silence, that we would remember the terrible cost of war, and that we would pray for peace. So for those of you who might be new to Canada and to Regina, tomorrow at 11, just before 11, people of Regina will gather around the cenotaph, as they do, whether it's minus 20 in snow, or whether it's like today, maybe just above zero. And there will be a moment of silence there, a huge crowd of people. And there's several places in the city. We gather to the cenotaph to be silent and to pray. And we also do that here, remembering those who have died in war. We remember the men and women serving in the Canadian military around the world today, and in Africa, in the Middle East, on our seas, and around all of our borders. And we remember the millions and millions of people affected by war today. So I invite you to stand as we sing one of our national hymns to begin our time of remembrance. God save our gracious King. Happy and glorious, long to reign, oh. They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. Let us pray to the Prince of Peace. Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you as your people. You are the one who has prepared the way for us to do this, and that is by laying down your own life. You have opened up a way for us to come into the presence of the Father. You are with us by your Holy Spirit. We pray indeed that you would receive all of our praise and thanks and service this morning, and that you would strengthen us and equip us for the week that is to come, we might serve you well in all things. In your name we pray. Amen. Welcome in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Let's take a moment to welcome one another in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let's continue in worship as we sing, "Be Unto Your Name."
We are a moment, you are forever, Jesus of ages, God before time. We are a vapor, you are eternal, love everlasting, reigning on high. Holy, holy Lord God Almighty, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Highest praises, honor, and glory be unto your name. Be unto your name. We are the broken, you are the healer, Jesus, Redeemer, mighty to save. You are the love song we'll sing forever, bowing before you, blessing your name. Holy, holy Lord God Almighty, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Highest praises, honor, and glory be unto your name. Be unto your name. mighty. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Highest praises, honor, and glory be unto your name. Be unto your name.
You may be seated.
It's flashing, so we'll see if I get through. Anyway, that was a little bit different order this morning. Sorry, that was a little bit confusing, but thank you for coming to the front. So I want to tell you a little story. When I was around your age, my sister and I went with my mom to the grocery store. Any of you do that? Go to the grocery store? You know how at the end, when you get are waiting at the till, there's all those chocolate bars and candies there. They're so tempting. Yeah, or Hot Wheels, all kinds of things that tempt us to want them. Well, my mom never let us get any of those things. We didn't need them, and that was okay, but we sometimes wanted them. And one time, we got home, and my mom discovered my sister opening a chocolate bar in secret somewhere. Do you think she'd paid for it? No, she had not. So what do you think my mom did? That's right. She did not call the police, but she did take my sister back to the store, and she made her go up to the people there and apologize for taking the chocolate bar, and I think she probably had to pay for it because I think she had opened it. But do you think my sister learned her lesson? Yeah, why do you learn your lesson when somebody catches you doing something? You want to just scoot over just a little bit, okay? So if somebody catches you doing something, are you less likely to do it again or more likely to do it again? What do you think?
Less likely.
Because it's not hidden anymore, right? You can't say, oh, I got away with it, so maybe I could take another chocolate bar next time and nobody will know. Instead, it was like, this was very embarrassing to have to go and admit that she had done wrong, right? Now, some things we do wrong are not on the outside like that. Just a minute, okay? Sometimes, I don't know, sometimes it's easier to think it's okay to sin on the inside, like think mean thoughts about people, but not say them out loud. Is it okay to still do that? Well, I mean, I suppose it's better than saying something mean out loud. But to God, God says we shouldn't even think those thoughts. If we do think them, we should ask for forgiveness and ask God to change our minds. Yes?
Your sister, like, in the CIA, like, how did she steal that chocolate?
Things happen, but... anyway, this morning, every morning, actually every Sunday morning, we have a time of confession. Confession is when we tell God what we have done wrong. Okay? And the reason we do that is, again, so that we become aware of some of the things that we're doing that are not right, so that we are less likely to do them again. In the Old Testament, people had to bring sacrifices. They had to get an animal, and that animal was killed for their sins, and then their sins would be forgiven. But when Jesus came, Jesus died, so we don't have to bring a sacrifice. But what we do need to bring still is our sins, things that we have done wrong, to God to ask for forgiveness. That's still really, really important. So back then, if you brought an animal, okay, so every...
Everybody over here has sinned. We've all done things that are wrong. Okay? But we have
Please join me in a prayer of confession. Merciful and loving God, we confess to you in front of all of heaven and one another that we have sinned against you in our thoughts, with our words, and with our actions. At times we have done things that we knew were wrong. Forgive us for what we have done, and help us to do right the next time. At times we have chosen to not do things that we know are right. Please forgive us for being selfish and uncaring. Forgive us for not loving ourselves and other people the way that you love us. At times this week, we have chosen to ignore you. We have not taken time to talk to you and to listen to you by praying and reading your words in the Bible. Forgive us for not loving you with our whole heart. We are truly sorry, and we come to ask for your forgiveness. Thank you, God, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross so that we will always be forgiven. Thank you that because you love us so much, we don't have to be afraid to come to you, and you will always forgive our sins. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, who helps us to love doing what is right, to live like Jesus did, and to follow your way of living. We do this because we love you, and we want to do what is right. We want to show your good way to the world, so that your name, God, would be celebrated everywhere we go. Amen. And in the Bible, in 1 John 1:9, it says, if we confess our sins, if we tell God what we have done wrong, then God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That means all of that bad stuff, anything you've just said to God, is all gone. God doesn't remember it anymore. Hallelujah, we are forgiven. Amen. All right, we'll head downstairs.
Please stand, let's sing together once again.
Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice. You became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I've wondered at your gift of life. I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again. And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you. Once again I pour out my life. Now you are exalted to the highest place, King of the heavens, where one day I'll bow. But for now, I've marveled at this saving grace. I'm full of praise once again. And I'm full of praise once again. And once again, I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you, once again I pour out my life. And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you, once again I pour out my life. I stand amazed in the presence. presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. For me it was in the garden, he prayed not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own grief, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in glory his face at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. And before we go into the scripture reading, please join me in a short prayer. My dear loving Lord God and Heavenly Father, the creator of the heaven and the earth, all seen and unseen things that you have created, Lord. We come this day with our heart full of thanks to you, Lord, that you have given us this chance that we are able to gather in this place of worship and give you praise. Lord, we come to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who came to this earth and sacrificed his own life in order to get or take the pain of our sins and the iniquities that we have. Lord, help us to remain faithful and be just when we fall into the times of temptation and we go through the hardship, so that our faith is renewed day in and day out, and we shall be able to see you when our time on this earth ends, Lord. We are thankful today especially for the souls, the brave souls who have fought for this country and never came home, Lord. I lift up the families of all those brave soldiers, Lord, as they remember them today. Give them the peace, Lord. I lift up each and every member of this congregation into your hand, Lord. You know our needs, may it be a physical, mental, medical, Lord. You take care of us. I lift up today's sermon into your hands, Lord. Let that be fruitful into our lives. I ask all these prayers into the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So our first reading is the epistles, and that is taken from Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 till 14, and it is about Christ's sacrifice once for all. Since the law has only a shadow of good things to come and not the true form of their realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered year after year, make perfect those who approach. Otherwise, would they not have chased being offered, since the worshipper, cleansed once for all, would no longer have any consequences of sin? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sin year after year. For it is impossible for the blood of bull and goats to take away sin. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offering and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." Then I said, "See, God, I have come to do your will, O God." When he said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings," then he added, "See, I have come to do your will." He abolishes the first in order to establish the second. And it is by God's will that we have been sanctified through the offerings of the blood of Jesus Christ, once for all. And every priest stands day after day at the service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away any sin. But when Christ has offered for all time a single sacrifice of sin, he sat down at the right hand of God. And since then he has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool of his feet. For by a single offering he had perfected for all things those who are sanctified. Our responsorial lesson is taken from Psalms 146, and it is in your bulletin, page 4. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals, in whom there is no help. When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On that very day, their plane perishes. Happy are those who help in the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord set the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. The Lord upholds the orphan and the widows. But the way of the wicked the Lord brings to ruin. The Lord will redeem forever. Your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord. If you are able to, please remain standing for the gospel lesson. And today's gospel is taken from the book of Mark, chapter 14, verses 53 to 64. And it's in your New Testament section of the Bible, page 52, if you want to follow. This is about Jesus before the council. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter has followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priest and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another made with hands.' But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, 'Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?' But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the priest asked him, 'Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?' Jesus said, 'I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.' Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, 'Why do you still need witness? You have heard the blasphemy. What is your decision?' All of them commanded to him as deserving death." This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated.
Why do we remember things? Remembering birthdays can be important. It can make a big difference in one's own well-being and happiness, remembering other people's birthdays. We remember the past when we are facing a challenging time in the moment. We remember that we have been through other times that were challenging, and somehow remembering those gives us, imparts something to us, something real is transmitted to us in our remembering, strength and courage and hope. We remember something from the past, something good, and it imparts a kind of joy and contentment to us as we remember something we are grateful for, something that was meaningful. We remember lessons learned so that we might avoid problems. We remember so that we say to ourselves, "I will never do that again." We remember so that we can say about others, "I will never let someone do that to me again." We remember, as we did yesterday with Eva McMillan, in order to honor someone we love, the people we care about. We remember, though, the cost of politics today and tomorrow, the cost of politics when things go wrong. It is a reminder to us always to guard against getting too excited about a political leader, whether it's excited because we're dismayed or excited because we're thrilled. Today and tomorrow is a reminder that our leaders are human and flawed, and sometimes the series of choices they make can be disastrous for us. We ought to vote trembling and concerned, deeply concerned, but the person that we are putting into power. We remember as a nation, though, the challenges that we have been through. And this gives us reason to be courageous and hopeful and confident going forward, knowing that we can trust in God and trust in one another and trust in many of the institutions that we have created to do what is right. But this is not a civil gathering, but a gathering of Christians. And so, as always, we are remembering Jesus' death on a cross. In one sense, Jesus was killed by politicians for political reasons. There are things to be leery of that we are warned about in the gospel accounts. We ought to be leery of politicians' need or desire to be expedient and to make expedient choices. For the Romans in power at the time, they were fine with whatever injustice might take place as long as the peace could be maintained. If that meant that Jesus, an innocent man, would be condemned to death and tortured, so be it, as long as the people did not riot. We can learn to be cautious and wary of politicians' indifferent to the suffering of others, and indifferent to the suffering that their choices create. We ought to listen for a politician who knows that the choices that they are making will inevitably hurt some of the people in their nation. Pilate pays no attention to the suffering Jesus will face. We ought to be wary of politicians full of pride and jealous of others. This is what seems to have been behind the motivation for the Jewish leaders to condemn Jesus to death. They saw Jesus' growing support and his popularity, and they wanted him dealt with. We ought to be leery in our politicians of any sign of arrogance, especially before God. Jesus was, after all, the very person that God had declared and chosen to be leader, not just of Israel, but of all nations. But he was rejected by all the governments at the time. We have Psalm 2 as the second psalm as a psalm for all the nations, that have been and will be. Why do they gather? Why do they conspire against the one that God has chosen? But God holds them in derision. Every nation has crumbled in the end. Every nation except the one that will destroy all of the kingdoms and countries that have been, the kingdom of God. The same time Jesus died by his own choice, he died for you. He died for me. He died for everyone. The single offering that the author of the letter of Hebrews is trying to understand, this single offering, is Jesus offering himself to God. In the moment that Jesus faced his death, he offered his own body, its death. And he said to God, "Let this be for everyone." Hebrews also says it is impossible for sacrifices to take away sins. Sacrifices cannot make anyone perfect. But we have all been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus once and for all. This is the promise that we repeat to ourselves, that Cheryl said to us this morning. Every Sunday we repeat this. You are forgiven, thanks to Jesus Christ. We are remembering today, and as I've said, some of the purposes for remembering the wrongs from the past is so that we would learn, we would say to ourselves, I never will do that again. Or that we could say to others, that can never happen again. You can never do that again. But at the same time, we are looking forward today to a time when we will forget all the sins that have been done. There are small ways that we experience this in life. I think we've all had the experience, or some of us have, especially if you're friends with me, someone will come to you and say, oh, I'm sorry for what I've done. And you say to the friend, you know, to be honest, I can't even remember the thing you're talking about. I've just forgotten it completely. It wasn't that they hadn't done something wrong, but you genuinely forgave them, perhaps even in the moment, and it was forgotten. God says to you, I will remember your sins no more. We need this promise and this hope. Perhaps I'm alone in this, but I suspect I am not. That mistakes and foolish things that I've said and done, some of them intentionally, some of them repeatedly, they come up unbidden into my memory and I can't get them out of my mind. They keep playing back, and I feel such shame and defeat and discouragement and disgust. I need this promise. You will not remember your sins. I will forget them. Jesus put forgiving others, however, at the center of all of his teaching, in the center of the Lord's Prayer. It is not just that you are forgiven, but that you must forgive others. It is not just that God will forget sins, But one day you will forget the sins that others have committed against you. This is a promise. In the moment, this seems unfair, hard, wrong. But it is meant to be a promise that one day you will be healed completely, that you will be comforted and filled with joy. In the moment, we can inch towards that promise if we forgive. If there is anyone in your life that you still need to forgive, no matter how hard it is, if you could inch towards that today. There is a point to remember the things that have been done that are wrong, but the time will come when we will forget. In the words of the author of the letter to the Hebrews, Jesus said, "Sacrifice and offerings you have not desired," he says this to God, "but a body you have prepared for me." And again, in a parallel statement, "In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure." And then I said, "See, God, I have come to do your will, O God." In these words, Jesus is recognizing that all of the sacrifices had not accomplished God's purpose to forgive and to transform God's people, to give them hearts full of love for God and love for each other. They had not accomplished that. But Jesus said, "I have this body. Take it. I have come to do your will." This was not only a sacrifice on our behalf, this was showing us the way towards life. We also have a body. And therefore, we are also called to say to God, "I have come to do your will." We say that every day of our life. And presumably, I think, at least I imagine this is the case, we practice saying that now, well, it's easy, so that as we approach death, when it is not so easy, we can join Jesus in saying, "I am here to do your will." Or in the words of Jesus in the Gospels, "I don't want to drink this cup, but not my will, but yours be done." But we remember the story about Jesus, and we remember that it is not a story about death, but about new life. God's will and plan was to forgive and to transform humanity. God did not have to be convinced by Jesus to do this. It wasn't that on the cross, Jesus did something and changed God's mind. But rather, right from the beginning, God's purpose always was that humanity would be perfect. That humanity would be, in Jesus' words, a temple, not built with human hands. Jesus said in his trial, that he came to make a temple not built with human hands. And what is a temple but a place on earth where we know we can go to find God, where God is physically present? Jesus is a temple, God among us. And you are to be a temple of God, a place where God will be physically present, where people can come to you and know that they are speaking with God. In the words of Hebrews, Jesus has perfected the saints so that we might come in and meet God face to face ourselves. All the religious services, all the practices and teachings of Israel and of all human cultures and religions, none of them have been enough to perfect any humans. But this is what Jesus did on the cross. He made a way for all of us to be perfected. It is not simply a question of whether or not we have been forgiven, but for God, it is a question of whether we are being transformed into the image that he always meant us to be. We are forgiven. But today we are called to live holy lives, to allow God to continue to do the work in us that is necessary as we are perfected and transformed. We remember Jesus' death, and the more we know him, And the more that we come to love him, the more it hurts, the more it hurts to think of his death on the cross. But remembering Jesus is different from remembering anybody else in our past, because Jesus Christ is alive and is with us. When anyone turns to him, Jesus is there with you. This is the invitation that Jesus sent out in the Gospels. Come and enter into my joy. By the grace of God, may we do that today and every day as we look to join him one day through our own death and birth into eternal life. Amen. I really wasn't sure how uncertain people would be feeling about the world as I chose the music for today. So I chose, I know, a song that's a favorite of many of you, and one that speaks to how much we don't know, but what it is we can be sure of. Let's sing together, "I Know Whom I Have Believed," hymn number 409 in the Brown Pew Hymnals, the words printed in your service bulletin for those joining us over Zoom. Let's sing together. You may be seated. Please join me in prayer. Almighty God, we see in your Son, Jesus Christ, how it is that you go about creating. Out of your love, you give of yourself sacrificially so that your creation might have life. We see that by your Holy Spirit that is present with us and around the world day after day, sustaining and renewing all things. And so we join with the saints and the angels, and we praise you as we look towards a day when you will make all things new. We come before you with our prayers and petitions for our world and for those in our lives and in our congregation. We pray for peace. We think of the many conflicts around the world, some born out of long-standing conflict and long histories of remembered wrongs. We pray for Russia and for Ukraine, for peace in their nations and in their people. We pray for peace in Sudan. We pray for Myanmar. We pray for Gaza and Israel, the West Bank, and especially for Lebanon, where we have many that we know. We pray that you would raise up leaders in all of these places who will put the welfare of the whole people ahead of their own self-interest or the interest of their immediate circle of supporters. Lord, have mercy. We lift up our own country to you, and we pray for Prime Minister Trudeau and the Parliament, for Premier Scott Moe and the legislature. And we pray that you would guard them from corruption, that you would help them to be wise and compassionate in all of their decisions. And we pray for the election this week in our city council, that you would raise up leaders for our city so that this might be a place where there is housing and employment and safety for everyone. We pray for our own congregation. We thank you for those who have stepped into leadership. We thank you for Derek, our chair, and pray that you would renew him and encourage him. We thank you for Kevin, 7 years as serving as treasurer. We thank you for the many ways that he works throughout the week and serving this congregation. We pray he would be blessed and enriched in this work. Know that he is loved and appreciated. We thank you for all the board members, that you would grant them wisdom, that you would call them to be in prayer. And we lift up the needs of those we love in this family. We think of the family of Eva McMillan, especially for her sister Margaret, as they grieve her passing. We thank you for the life that she lived as an example to us. May we even manage to live a life of, even a bit of a life, the life of service that she modeled for us. We pray for Ru Shui in Myanmar right now, that you would keep him safe and bring him home safely to his family. We pray for the Carbnos, who are sick at the moment. We think especially of Shirley's mother in hospital. Lord, have mercy on them and bless them. We pray for Isabel, who has had to move and is in a place where she is recuperating and regaining strength. We pray that she would continue to smile and have reasons to be grateful for the goodness of her family and of your goodness. We pray for Bryden's father, that you would continue to restore him. We pray for Carol Hepting's brother, Brian. We pray that you would have mercy on him and all his family as he sits unresponsive and in ICU. We pray that all the family would turn to you and find in you hope and comfort and strength. Bless Carol's presence and her words. May they accomplish your purpose in the lives of her family. We pray for all who are facing illness and are waiting for diagnosis at the moment. Lord, we pray that they would be patient, that they would be comforted, that they would know that of your love in their lives, and that we would be able to be a comfort and support to them as well. We think of Nganga and his family in South Africa. We pray that they would have the means that they need each day to have for food and housing. And we gather up all of these prayers, the prayers that remain unspoken. We entrust them into your care, and we pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I also meant to say, as part of the prayer, Vicky, welcome back. We've missed you over the past few months, and hope your time went well. Welcome back, Vicky. Thank you. And we bring to God these tithes and offerings. They are just a small sign of our desire to turn our lives over to God in thanks for all that God has done for us. Now as you go with the blessing of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Amen.